after the physical attributes of lioness and strong drink that God warned us about. And I want to get through this today. It's a little bit long, but hopefully I can squeeze it in 15, 20 minutes. Lord, we need you here today, Father God. There's many people here that have a need today. We need everyone to receive this message. It's just so important because we have to have it settled in our hearts. The days are getting very dark. The sodomites are moving in around us. There's courses here in Suriname teaching young men how to be sodomites now and how to act effeminate. And oh Lord, we've got to get this message through so that we're not fooled by all this. Okay, Lord, I just want to ask you, Lord, just touch everyone today. Let's let it totally settle in their hearts so they can answer another. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Okay, now last week we ended up in Luke 21, 34 to 35, and we were talking a little bit about surfeiting, which is only mentioned once in the Bible. I said some things I think that I need to really clarify. If we go back to that verse, Luke 21, 34 to 35, and Jesus actually said this. He said, "And take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, and so that day come upon you unawares." In other words, when Jesus returns to take his bride, you don't want it to come to you unaware. You don't want to be doing all this stuff. You don't want to be involved in your text conversations all day. It doesn't mean you can't text. It doesn't mean you can't play a game online on the internet. But you know what, guys? This really convicted me, this word surfeiting, because it's only in the scriptures once, and I took something out of a dictionary to give you a meaning for it. And it really convicted me, so I thought, what did the other Bibles say? Open all the other Bibles. I have a whole bunch of other Bibles, and I have all the resources to see what all the other Bibles say. They took it out. God, Jesus himself, this word comes up in his mouth, surfeiting, and surfing the internet, surfing. This is so close. Why would they think that God only took it on the new Bible verses, they changed its meaning to something totally opposite, so that we couldn't see what Jesus was trying to tell us. So it's very important to use the King James Bible, especially when I'm up here teaching you guys. If you don't have the King James Bible, you're going to miss a lot. Okay? So we're going to slip over to Romans 13, 13 to 14. Now, is your heart more hard for or getting filled with the joy and the Spirit of the Lord? Come on, guys. I read your Bibles too. Okay. Romans 13, 13 to 14. "Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness." As in the day, well, we're children of the light. We're children of the light. If you're born again, you're children of my child of light. Okay? "Not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof." Okay, now we're going to go a little bit over to 1 Corinthians 5:11. "But now I have written unto you, not to keep company, if any man that is called a brother be a fornicator, or covetous, or an adulterer, or a railer, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, which such a one do not eat." Now, it doesn't matter what pastor in the past told you it's okay to drink. Okay? It doesn't matter. Because God says it's incompatible with your Christian life. Going back into when all the children in the wilderness, for 40 years they had no wine or strong drink. God says it's incompatible. You can't know me. You can't know me. So, you know, they didn't tell you the truth. Because you can't go out there sitting with wild sinners. God warned us what would happen if we do that. You know, and associate with them. You can go there and give them the truth. Give them a gospel tract if you're ashamed to talk about the truth. Give them a gospel tract or something. If you don't have the right words, you don't have your Bible with you. Take some gospel tracts. They're free. Take a whole bunch with you. Okay, 1 Corinthians 6:10-11 is, "Nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God." These guys aren't going to inherit the kingdom of God sitting out there, and we're not to sit there and have fellowship with them. Go witness to them, sure, no problem. But don't sit there and have fellowship with them. "And such were some of you, but you are washed,
You're sanctified.
But you're justified in the name of the Lord Jesus.
And by the Spirit of our God. Spend time here by the Spirit of our God.
Galatians 5:19-22. A little bit further over. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envying, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in the past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness,
goodness, faith. That's the fruit they need to see from us. Okay?
And notice up there, it says, and it's murderous drunkenness. Now,
drunkenness is right next to murder. Take good note of that. Right next to murder. You know, strong drink is self-administered suicide. You know, that the two are inseparable. The one leads to the other. Alcohol is the most lethal drug out there. Alcohol is a drug. It's classified as a drug. The Food and Drug Administration classifies alcohol as a drug. It's the most lethal drug. It's going to kill you. And accepted by many modern churches. You know those churches in America, they have breweries right in their church. So after you finish, or even during worship, you can go in there and have a beer and chug it back while you're worshiping Jesus Christ. What Jesus? That's another Jesus, another spirit, another gospel. Right in the churches. Some of the biggest churches in America have breweries in them right now. Many diseases come from alcohol. Alcohol eats holes in your liver. It's called cirrhosis of the liver. Your liver's full of holes. It doesn't function right. You can't control your bodily functions. Your liver gets full of holes. My grandfather died of that. He was just a mess. So, alcohol is a drug. Let's see the worldly description of this. This is from the Food and Drug Administration. Ethanol, which is alcohol, is listed as a psychoactive drug. A psychoactive drug is a chemical substance that crosses the blood-brain matter and acts primarily upon the central nervous system, where it affects brain function, resulting in alterations in perception, mood, consciousness, cognition, and behavior. Lupulin is an additional psychoactive drug found in wine and beer. There's a drug in wine and beer. You know that?
Okay. Lupulin is a hypnotic and sedative drug.
Wow. And that's in that little drink of wine that's okay for you guys to drink.
Ethanol and lupulin are both addictive substances classified as narcotics in the United States of America. Alcohol is a narcotic.
Because there's stuff for adding it too. Careful, guys.
It's poison. Proverbs 23:32.
I'll show you it's poison. God warned us it's poison.
At last, it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder.
A serpent and an adder bite you, you're dead. Poison. Lethal.
Who is behind that bottle of wine or beer?
They call it spirits in the world. They call it spirits.
Oh, there's spirits in that drink, you know?
And you read any bottle, get an alcohol bottle, go into a liquor store, just read every bottle in there. Take an hour, redo it. Spirit of this, spirit of that, the spirits.
They're transferring spirits into your body through that drink. Now, old timers always said, there's a devil in that bottle.
I'll tell you guys today, they're right. They're absolutely right.
That's who's behind it. Because right here, at last, it biteth like a serpent and stingeth like an adder. Who's a serpent in the garden? Lucifer. There's a devil in that bottle. Now, bars all have,
before I go to the next part of the scripture, bars all have ladies' night.
You read all these signs all over town, ladies' night, free drinks, especially in America and Canada and Europe. Ladies' night, free drinks. Why do they want to get the ladies in there?
The next scripture tells us, God warns us. That's why they want to get the ladies in there.
Thine eyes shall behold strange women, and thy heart shall utter perverse things.
This is verse 33, Proverbs 22:23.
Then we go a little bit further to Habakkuk. We'll go back to Habakkuk. This is kind of important. Go back to Habakkuk 2:15. That's back in the Old Testament. I've got to bring that one in because it's very important. Woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink. You know, you take that bottle of wine next door, maybe it's New Year's. Here, have a drink, buddy. Whoa! When God says whoa, we talked about whoa. When God says whoa, he's real serious. Whoa unto him that giveth his neighbor drink, that putteth thy bottle to him, and makest him drunken also, that thou mayest look on their nakedness. See, alcohol, nakedness, they go together. Now, 30% of drownings involve alcohol. I'm just going to read some statistics here. 30% of all suicide, alcohol. That drunk alcohol. 45% of auto deaths. You know, but the funny thing is, the drunks that are driving, they're all limber, they bounce around a car when it crashes, they kill you, they kill your babies, they kill your moms, they kill your dads, they kill all kinds of people. Their body just bounces around and they survive. Whoa. 60% of all homicides, people that murder, boy, they got to murder, alcohol. 80% of deaths in fire, alcohol. I saw this personally happen. I witnessed this. I was up in a mining camp, way above the Arctic Circle in the Arctic Canada. And this guy was so drunk, he went in his room and a cigarette, and he fell asleep in the cigarette. His dad turned around, and the whole bunkhouse was full of smoke. We were all ripping doors open, trying to find this fire. He was still sound asleep. His dad was on fire all around him. 80% of deaths in fire, alcohol. 80% of all arrests. You know, get arrested, go to jail, it involves alcohol. Jeremiah 17:9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? So add alcohol to a heart that's full of deceit, and the heart's where they're singing music. Follow my heart, follow my heart. Always about your heart, your heart, your heart. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. You add alcohol to that, a wicked heart, you got a big problem. You're full steam ahead, suicide. Ephesians 6:12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of the world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. While Lucifer is in high places, I will be above, like the Most High. I will sit above the stars of God. Intoxication causes increased compulsiveness. So if you're a gambler and you like the casinos, they always give you free drinks. Why do you think they do that? Huh? It goes to work, but I'm going to win. Compulsive, compulsive, compulsive. Okay? And now, habitual inclination. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the Webster's Dictionary here because it's very important to this. You know, Webster's 1928, if you look at the word addiction, in the old Webster's, look at the word addiction. What does it say? The act or state of being devoted. Devoted? Yeah. I'm devoted to this. You see? There's good addictions. All addictions aren't bad. Devoted to this. Now what did the new dictionary say? Get a new dictionary and read up on this. This is very, could be very interesting to you guys. Webster's 1955. We went from 1828 to 1955. The condition of being addicted to a habit, habitual inclination. They changed it from a positive meaning to a negative meaning. You guys read the dictionary, what does this mean? Oh, well, it's negative, like a negative in my life. Careful. Even the dictionary can warn us. So, what's the biblical definition? That's what we need to know. We're in Proverbs 9:8. Reprove not a scorner, lest he hate thee. Rebuke a wise man, and he will love thee. Remember when I was talking a little bit before about being wise, not drinking alcohol? You're not sure who? You guys are all wise in here. I know that. So I'm going to, you know, I'm going to rebuke, and you're going to love me for it. The truth. Okay? So we need to replace these harmful addictions with good addictions. So if you like doing a lot of these things that are harmful that God warns us about, replace them with a good addiction. And I'm going to show you the test. There's a test that we can measure ourselves to know if what we're doing is right in the eyes of the Lord. So I'm doing this study to help Christians out there. Some people in the world will hear it and it'll touch them too. And hopefully, you know, they get to know the Lord. But I'm doing it to help you, Christians, not to hurt you or your feelings. I don't want to say, well, I know you guys drink wine and supper every day because it was your family tradition and you think it's good for your health. I'm not doing this to hurt you guys and hurt your feelings. Because there are addictions that are very good. Now, let's take a look over back to the New Testament, 1 Corinthians 3:17. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. You are the holy temple of God. And you're going to put something in there that's going to make your heart wicked and perverse, and put perverse thoughts in your mind. You're the temple of God, which temple ye are. 1 Corinthians 6:19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? So you go to these churches, they want to touch you on the head, knock you back, let you shake on the floor, put this other spirit inside you. The Holy Ghost is already in you. They're knocking him out of you. They're putting another spirit in you. See, that's going to be the next message. We're going into the spiritual wilderness. Okay, so the big test. Can you sit in the bar, or can you go meet some friends, drink some wine, and gossip with them for an hour? Can you do it for 3 or 4 or 5 hours? Have a little get-together, 4 or 5 hours with your friends? Gossip? Talk about old times? Okay. What's the test? Can you pick this up when you go home and spend that 4 or 5 hours with the Lord Jesus Christ? If you can't do that, you're surfeiting. That's your test. You can't pick this book up and read it, but you can go up and gossip and talk about all the things of the world with your buddies and your friends. That's your test. And I hope you're all convicted of it, those here that aren't spending time in here in God's Word. Because I worked through this at least 12 times, cover to cover. And every day I'm in this book. And every day God shows me something else that's new and refreshes me. And just, wow, I never saw that before. Thank you, Lord. You're not spending any time in there. So, 2 Timothy 3:4. Traitors, heedy, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. You know, you wake up with a hangover. If you're drinking, if you're drunker, you wake up with that hangover, your head's splitting, you got no dignity, no esteem. You might even wake up and someone else is dead. Maybe you're with your head in a toilet bowl. You think you can handle liquor well? You think you can bring your kids up and tell them it's okay? Like, one of my kids asked me, is it okay to have a drink of wine once a year, Daddy, on New Year's or something? You think it's okay to tell your kids that? What if that same child of mine takes my car keys when I fall asleep that night and starts up that car and takes it for a joy ride and smashes into a pool and is dead? Who's responsible for that? You, because you said, it's okay to have a little drink. You're responsible for that. Set an example for your children. Ephesians 5:18. And be not drunk with wine, wherein in excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now this verse is showing us, it looks like, well, it's okay if we can drink wine, but this verse is showing us something very important. This verse is showing you that God has a better way. His Spirit. Man, I've drunk a lot of wine in my life. And I've drunk a lot of strong drink in my life. And we're going to talk about that, not right now. But I tell you, when I read these words, I've never had the amount of pleasure that this book gives me. God's Word gives me. The Spirit. I'm filled with the Spirit. So, 1 Thessalonians 5:5-9. Ye are children of the light. Ah, we talked about that. He showed us that. God showed us that before. And the children of the day. And we are not of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober. You know, some people, all it takes is one drink of wine, one beer, maybe one shot of alcohol, and they're drunk. They're stone drunk. How can you be sober if you're drinking? You can't be sober at all if you're drinking. How can there's drugs in there that are affecting your mood? You can't be sober. God warned us, be sober. For they that sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. For they that sleep in the night, and they that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober. He warned us again, be sober. Putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. Guess what? You can't put on that helmet if you're drinking. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation from the Lord Jesus Christ. Born again Christians are sober. Children of the light, not darkness. If you're not sober, there's a wrath. Remember I talked about going around the corner? God's standing right there! There's a wrath. You're out of your body, it's too late, it's over, you don't have time to repent.
He took you, the day of the Lord, you're gone. Except you're not gone.
Where we, as Bible believers, are promised, you're gone somewhere else. You'll be cast in the lake of fire. Verse 2 to 3. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife. Well, how does that work with all these churches in America now who have woman pastors and they're married to another woman? How can they be the husband of one wife? They call themselves a husband? I don't know how they do that. Vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach. Not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy liquor. But distinguishes money, filthy lucre is money. But patient, not a brawler, nor covetous. I used to be a brawler, guys, a big brawler. I broke bones. I got some stories to tell you. But thank you, Jesus, that He took me out of all that. Thank you, Jesus. Titus 2:1-4. But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine, and the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, and patience. The aged woman likewise, that they be in behavior and become holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things, that they may teach the young woman to be sober, to love their husbands, love their children. Titus 2:6, a little bit further down. Young men likewise, exhort to be sober-minded. Can't be sober-minded if you're drinking. Titus 2:11-12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. That's right now where we are. 1 Peter 1:13. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 4:7. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober. Watch unto prayer. 1 Peter 5:8. We're still in the book of Peter. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, is a roaring lion, and he's in those bottles, walking about seeking whom he may devour. Now, there's a lion that's around the corner just waiting to devour you. Jesus never sinned. Or he never broke a law. So he couldn't have drunk alcohol. Because he's warning us all against it. Couldn't have drunk alcohol. It wasn't alcohol. It was wine. New wine. The word wine simply means it came from the vine. That's the definition. It came from the vine. Squeeze. We stopped at the beginning. Squeeze. Straight the vine. Put it in the Pharaoh's cup and give it to him. So good wine is new wine. You didn't know your Bible said all this, did you guys? About alcohol. You didn't know that. Well, next week we're going to get into strong drink and spiritual drunkenness. Spiritual drunkenness, which is just as bad and much worse than what we've been thinking. Now, don't do it. Don't do it. It's the falling away that God warned us about. These pastors and churches hit people in the head. They're falling back. They're falling away. Don't do it. Don't get spiritually drunk. There's churches that are seen as the Holy Ghost bartender. And they're actually feeding you physical alcohol as well as spiritual alcohol. Don't do it, guys. Don't do it. If the Lord takes me, I don't make it the next week. Don't do it. You know, it's wicked. Okay, I'll turn this back over to Pastor James. And thanks for...